All right, gang. Well, as previously stated, this is the final countdown, last chapter of Abnormal Psychology, and I am excited to be doing it for you guys. So, we are looking at disorders of age and cognition in the textbook. Little intro for you guys. So what I want you guys to do for the activity, if you'd like to, is to find an object. Maybe it's car keys, maybe it's your phone. If you've got a nicotine device, that would be great. Take a little break for 25 minutes or so. Hide it, or not hide it, but just put it somewhere that you normally don't have it. And I will explain why later. I'm also going to attach some memory games with my presentation, if you guys would like to do those as well. It's a little activity. It's not like there's much else to do right now, so freshen up your brain a little bit with some memory games. Another little side note while we're at it, the slides are not that great. I know, they don't look that great, but I put the facts on there, you know what I mean? The facts are on the slides. I'm also going to be talking, so hopefully in conjunction, everything works out great, and we all learn a little bit from this. So, without further ado, I think we should get into it. Let's get into it. Okay, so I'm actually really stoked to be doing this presentation, or this chapter at least, because I have a little bit of personal background with a lot of these disorders. So, after I graduated high school in 2017, class of 2017, I took a year off, and I did some traveling, and a lot of my family members were like, college, 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 and I was just like, okay, everybody, let's just hold our horses a little bit here. I don't know what I want to do. I don't want to spend money if I don't know what I want to do. Now I'm at CMC, long story short. I decided that I wanted to check out a certified nursing program, because for a long time I had wanted to do healthcare, you know, maybe when I was like 7, I wanted to be a doctor, and then, you know, things happen, and then I was like, okay, more practical, maybe I'll do nursing. But before I do that, and before I go and spend money and get a nursing degree, I need to see if it's something I actually want to do. So there was this nursing home when I lived in Boulder. It was called Mesa Vista, and they had a program basically where you would go and you would work there for a couple months, and if they liked you and if you liked it, they would send you to nursing school, or not... Not nursing school. That would have been really cool. No, CNA school. And then you get your CNA certification and then you work for them. So I did that on my year off. I worked at a nursing home. And I would also just like to preface this with, it was a, what they call like a last stop nursing home. So a lot of the people who live there have been kicked out of other nursing homes. A lot of them are formerly homeless. So you get a really good mix of people in a place like that. So I really saw, I don't want to say it all, but I saw a lot. So a little background information. I'm hoping I can share some stories with you guys so you can have a little more context about a lot of these disorders, because a lot of them, the way the book describes them is very clinical, and it's pretty much, you know, it's the DSM-5. So it's like you have this, this, and this, and you have this. So, which is true, but it doesn't really give a super accurate description for how a lot of these disorders really show up and what they look like. So I'm hoping I can do that for you guys, zest it up a little bit with my own stories. So let's start off on slide number 1, if you've got the slides pulled up. Hopefully you had time to find whatever object it was you chose to place in a different location, and we will get started. So slide number 1 is going to be a picture of a person that's drawn, and there's like chunks of his head that are coming out. They're not there anymore. They're leaving his head. You could say he's losing his mind. So there's gonna be a lot of that. You guys just get used to that. If you're not watching, I just winked. So this picture is really powerful, because that is what these disorders of age and cognition do, is it literally makes these people lose their minds. Like, there are pieces of them that are not there anymore. And so I thought it was a really powerful image, and that's why I chose to include that. So we're going to flip over to the next slide, slide number 2. And basically, so disorders of age and cognition, they are disorders that occur, generally speaking, over the age of 65. That is considered old in our culture. And a lot of them used to be referred to as like dementia, but dementia is kind of a general term. So, you know, you can have dementia and not have one of these disorders. You could just be old with dementia. So, you know, just regular memory loss, things that just happen as you get older. And so as you get older, like other stages of your life that you go through when you're growing up, adolescence, you know, middle-aged, you have biological changes that you undergo. And so when you're older, a lot of it is with your brain and obviously your body too. You know, you start to shrink and you get arthritis in your hands and things like that. You know, it's their biological changes that are normal that you go through. So with these cognitive disorders, that's obviously of your mind, they're cognitive disorders. So we are going to hit slide number 3 now, and we're going to talk about depression. So depression is extremely common for people who are older. There is so much stuff that these people are going through that all kind of happens at once, if that makes sense. So a big one is loss of your life partner. So you live with somebody, you're married to them, you have kids with them for, let's say, 50 years of your life, and then they pass away. That is a huge, major traumatic event that will absolutely cause you to be depressed. That is one of the biggest ones, I think. And then, you know, you have loss of friends, illnesses. If you have like a chronic illness that you've been dealing with, that can also make you depressed. And then people who live in nursing homes actually have higher rates of depression than elderly people who don't live in nursing homes. And that can be for a variety of reasons. But if you've never been to a nursing home, the best way I can paint the picture for you is they are sterile, clinical. It's very much like a hospital. It's a little different, but you know, you don't have a nice big bed anymore. You have a little bed, unless you're at like a really ritzy place. But the place I worked at, not ritzy, Last Chance Nursing Home. It was also like Medicaid, Medicare paid for it. It was not a private nursing home. So that's my bias when I'm telling you this stuff. So you have lost a lot of the things that you have been used to your entire life. You know, you're not living with your family anymore. You're living in a new place. And you know, that's a big deal. That is hard. So that can make you depressed. Lots of things like that. So on the next slide, slide number 4, pretty much the treatments, very similar to other ages, antidepressant medication, some cognitive-based therapy is what they are going to utilize for elderly people experiencing depression. So, and that can be mitigated pretty well, but I think a lot of it is just because of the age they're at and how many things are happening to them that are changes. It's a big deal. So that is that for treatments. So the next slide, slide number 5, is going to be anxiety disorders. Basically, that can be caused by, again, like depression, a lot of things. Declining health, it's treated with anti-anxiety medication, that is pretty much all there is about that. But it's very similar to people our age, again, like with depression, they treat it the same way. Just a little side note, I think almost everybody at the place I worked at was on an antidepressant. So that's kind of to show like how large the scope of depression is in nursing homes. So slide number 6, cognitive disorders. We're going to talk about delirium. So I don't know if you've ever heard anybody say that they're like delirious before. It's a big one. So it can occur at any age, but it is very, very common for older people. And so if you've ever heard somebody talk about like sundowning, or if, I think there's like a movie about that. I forgot what the name is. But basically, it's like this whole state of delirium that these people are in for pretty much after the sun goes down is typically when it happens. So because it's confusing for them. So it can be from a variety of things too. You can get it from an infection, diseases. If you have a high fever, you can be delirious. It's stuff like that. And it's basically just confusion and you don't understand what's going on in your environment at the time. So that's what delirium is. And it's really, really, really common in the elderly. So, and that can be from medications that they take. It can be from drug use. Substance abuse is also really big for elderly people. And sometimes I don't think they know it necessarily, but it's like, you know, they take like 5 medications a day, sometimes more than that. At least 5, I think, is the average. So, that can be a whole thing. The place I worked at, like I said, it was in Boulder. And so if we're talking about substance abuse, I'll just derail really quick for you guys. They had this patio where we would take people out to go smoke cigarettes. Well, they would also smoke marijuana on that patio, which was kind of funny to see. And I remember the first day I was working, somebody was like, oh, go take them out for a smoke break. And I was like, okay. So I go out there and there's just these guys like sitting around in a circle, you know, getting high at a nursing home. And I was just like, wow, okay, this is interesting. So obviously that's going to interfere with any medications, which can cause even more delirium. It's just, that's a big deal for older people. So the next slide. Hopefully you guys know who that is. This is going to be slide number 7. We are looking at, I think, the 44th president of the United States, Ronald Reagan. And the quote under it is, I now begin this journey into the sunset of my life, which is a really nice quote. I just thought that was nice. And it's actually from a letter that he and Nancy Reagan addressed to the nation after he left office because there had been accusations that he had had Alzheimer's disease while he was in office. So, people had speculated that Ronald Reagan had Alzheimer's while he was in office, and he eventually died in 2004. So, it's a big deal. Anybody can get it. Lots of people get it, even the president of the United States, Ronald Reagan. So, wanted to include that in there just so you guys know that, you know, really important people can get this disease as well. So, the next slide, slide number 8, is going to be Alzheimer's. And it's actually going to be the next several slides, just so you guys know. This whole chapter is kind of about Alzheimer's. But there's other diseases too, just so you know. Mostly Alzheimer's. So Alzheimer's, as defined by the DSM-5, is a significant decline in one area of cognitive functioning. So that can be language, motor skills, walking around, stuff like that. There's a whole list of them, and it's if you're declining in at least one of those areas. So for Alzheimer's, you have mild or you have major Alzheimer's. So mild is where you are still able to function fairly independently, and major is where you cannot function independently anymore. So you are living in a nursing home, you have somebody taking care of you full time. It is majorly affecting your life. So next slide, it's going to be slide number 9, more about Alzheimer's. So there's, I think it's between 24 and 36 million people in the world have neurocognitive disorders. So, excuse me, that is a large chunk of the population. If you think about it, that's pretty significant. That is a huge chunk of the elderly population as well. So a lot of people have it. It's a big deal. So basically with Alzheimer's, you have early onset and then you have late onset Alzheimer's. And so early onset is somebody who is maybe at the end of middle age, or middle-aged. So there was this lady that I worked with, and she had early onset Alzheimer's, and I think she couldn't have been more than like 55, but she didn't remember. She had a son, you know, she didn't remember anybody's name, you know. She knew her name though, which was good. So that is early onset, basically where you're just a lot younger. And then late onset is, after the age of 65. So, and it is named after Alois, I think is how you say his name, Alzheimer, and he was a German physician who formally identified the disease in 1907. So we'll get into a little bit more of the identification process later on. I just want to do another little tidbit here for you guys. So basically, when I worked at this place, they would have you kind of go through the different floors. There was 4 floors, and then you would get to the memory care unit, which was the first floor. And that was absolutely the hardest shift I have ever worked. It was 12-hour shifts, which is pretty typical for nursing places. And I got home and I cried for a while because it was so impactful, the things that you see. And it's like, you don't really think about it that much until you have experienced it or if you have a family member with it. I'm sure some of you people know. You know, some of you guys know people with Alzheimer's or a neurocognitive disorder, but it is some heavy, heavy stuff. I mean, it's not just like, you know, grandma can't remember certain things. I mean, these people can't talk. They don't remember who they are. They don't remember their family when they come to see them. So that was a really, really hard day for me. And the people who work in memory care, I think, are really hardcore. It's hardcore. And I worked on that floor a lot, actually. So, not to say that I'm hardcore, I'm just saying people who do it like on a regular basis, because obviously I don't work there anymore. I have a lot of respect for those people because it's kind of like the person inside of them in these people who have these disorders isn't really there anymore because of what's going on with their brains. So I just wanted to kind of throw that in so you guys understand what is going on for these people when they have this, if you've never experienced it yourself. So slide number 10 is going to be pretty much so you can live for up to 20 years if you have received the diagnosis of Alzheimer's. But generally speaking, the time between onset, which is when the symptoms start, and then death is 8 to 10 years. So that's a pretty short amount of time in retrospect, if you think about it. So it basically starts with really mild symptoms. So it might be something like you're not finishing your sentences all the way, but you know, certain things that you used to be good at, you can't do anymore: cooking, reading, cleaning, things like that, you know, activities of daily living. So just stuff that you can't do very well anymore, but you're still pretty much able to do them. And so as time goes on, your symptoms worsen. And so you are unable to do those things on your own anymore. So you need someone to help you. So that can be, you know, a caregiver, someone who lives with you. If you live in a nursing home, obviously there's a whole staff to help you with things like that there. And it eventually leads to total dependence on other people. So you are no longer able to do anything by yourself. So it is pretty heavy. So slide number 11, just more on Alzheimer's. So it's responsible for 75,000 deaths per year in the United States. And that is pretty significant just considering how many other things can kill you. 75,000 seems like a lot. I mean, I think it's a lot. I don't know. I mean, heart disease is definitely responsible for more, but just the fact that this is a cognitive disease that can pretty much, like, it's just your brain deteriorates, like, to the point where you cannot function. So it's responsible for a lot of deaths. It can only be diagnosed post-mortem. So you don't officially know if someone has Alzheimer's until after they've passed away, and you can look at their brain, and you will see in the ridges of their brain that there are gaps. They look more, you know, just not as robust as a normal healthy brain would. So that is how they diagnose Alzheimer's. It's post-mortem. I think now you can do like a PET scan and stuff like that, and you can kind of see, but it can't officially be diagnosed until post-mortem. So one of the main causes are these things called senile plaques. And so basically they're sphere-shaped deposits of a molecule called the beta amyloid protein, which basically forms spaces in the brain. And so all of these, you know, wedges in your brain and things that have been pruned over time, and, you know, you've created your brain from growing up and living and doing all your stuff, basically start to get separated. So you're not having those neural connections anymore. So that is basically what they think the deal is. And that's what you see when you look at a brain. So slide number 12 is going to be genetics. Early onset runs in families, so that is going to be genetic. Late onset is not genetic, typically, is what they think. There's not a lot that's really known about this, because if you think about it, I mean, with genetics specifically, we just sequenced the human genome in 2000, so there is still so much that we're learning. But they think that it is caused by a gene that's on chromosome 19, which is called the APOE gene. So, slide 13 is going to be other effects that can also potentially trigger Alzheimer's disease, which if you think about it, it's a lot like autoimmune diseases. They think a lot of environmental effects can cause like multiple sclerosis or lupus, things like that. So zinc, if you have too much zinc, can lead to more plaque buildup, which will again create those gaps in between your brain. And then lead, which is very interesting, specifically with this generation of elderly people that we're seeing right now, so like baby boomers and then, you know, above that, there was lead in like everything. Like the paint on your walls had lead, and you could get like lead poisoning. You know, it was in the pipes, it was in pencils, like there was lead in everything, okay? And I, to say the least, I mean, that couldn't have been good for multiple reasons, but I wouldn't be surprised if it somehow affected, you know, Alzheimer's disease as well. So autoimmune theory is basically, with like an autoimmune disease, again, your aging brain cells triggers an autoimmune response, which then causes Alzheimer's. So an autoimmune disorder basically is where you have a disease where your immune system is basically attacking itself, which is not good, not preferable. So And then the last one is going to be the viral theory. So there is a disease called Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, which is pretty much, it's very similar to Alzheimer's, but it's caused by a virus. So it's one of those viruses basically where it lays dormant in your body. It hides from the immune system for years, and then something triggers it, and then you get sick. So one of the theories is that maybe Alzheimer's is caused by something like that, but they are not 100% sure. Speculative, allegedly. So next slide's going to be, next slide is slide 14, which is a picture of two different brains, and I'm pretty sure you guys can tell which one is Alzheimer's and which one is not. I also think they're labeled. So basically, you can see that the one that's normal is more robust, it's thick, you can see those regions really nicely, and then the other one, it looks sick, it's not, you know, it just doesn't look good. It's not good. So the other thing I just wanted to point out really quick that I think they didn't really talk about in the book is you can get alcohol-related dementia, which is basically when you drink so much that your brain, same thing, I mean, you pretty much display the same symptoms of Alzheimer's, but you don't have Alzheimer's. You got it from drinking too much, which there was a guy like that at the place I worked, and that was one of the saddest cases that I remember seeing there. So that's interesting as well. Just wanted to point that out. So, slide 15, we have other diseases. So there's also other neurocognitive diseases that they touched on in this chapter. So, you are going to see vascular neurocognitive disorder, stroke. Basically some of your brain is not getting enough blood for an extended period of time and you have a stroke. Pick's disease, it affects the frontal and temporal lobes. It's very similar to Alzheimer's as well, but it's, again, only established after death. So, and then prions, I think another example of prions. So you have the Creutzfeldt-Jakob's disease again. I think mad cow disease is a prion, and then also chronic wasting disease is a prion as well. So if you guys are ever driving around and you see like a herd of cows and then there's just like one elk within the herd of cows or something, usually it has chronic wasting disease, which means it is just its brain, same thing as Alzheimer's, it's confused, and so it's just hanging out with its cow buddies. So that is an example of prions causing the same kind of neurocognitive disorders, but people have them as well. So Huntington's disease, for me, this was by far the worst one that I saw. I mean, Alzheimer's is pretty bad, but Huntington's disease is far more progressive than Alzheimer's. And it's 100% genetic, so it's not something that you can just get, like, environmentally. So basically, if one of your parents has it, you have a 50% chance of having it as well. And so, same thing, I mean, it affects your movement, your memory, your speech. There was a lady there who my coworkers had told me about, and so they said, she used to talk like 6 months ago, and she was completely bedbound by the point that I had started working there. So that's how fast Huntington's can move, it's different for person to person, but for her, that's, you know, how progressive it was. Last one is going to be Parkinson's disease. That's going to be slide 16. And I included some pictures of one of my favorite actors. That's Michael J. Fox. He is very well known for being a Parkinson's advocate. So the top picture is him in Family Ties, which is a wonderful TV show from the 80s, and I would recommend it if you've never seen it. There is speculation that towards the end of it, once he was starting to show symptoms of it, you can actually see it in some of his acting. You guys probably know him from Back to the Future, though. So, and then that's him in Teen Wolf, also a fantastic movie if you haven't seen it. Parkinson's, tremors, unsteadiness, memory. All these neurocognitive disorders all kind of affect the same things and kind of do the same stuff, basically. So, you know, it's stuff with your memory, your movement, all the stuff that your brain is really, really helpful for. So, next slide, 17, is going to be treatments. So, I don't want to say that these are like, you can't treat them at all, but they're incurable. I mean, you can't get rid of any of these diseases. They're things that you have to live with. So there are drug treatments for stuff like this. Basically, they target the neurotransmitters that are responsible for memory. So acetylcholine and then glutamine are the transmitters that are responsible for your memory. So these drugs will target those and hopefully help. But basically, I think for a lot of these, like if you have early onset Alzheimer's, they will give these to you as kind of like to slow down the effects. But again, it doesn't stop it and it doesn't get rid of it. It just slows it down. And then vitamin E in conjunction with these is supposed to help, which I thought was interesting. I hadn't heard that before. So vitamin E is supposed to be helpful for these neurocognitive disorders as well. And then group therapy is very, if you go to any nursing home, like you see group therapy, you know, you'll see everybody sitting in a circle and they're doing something, you know, so they try to do that a lot. Not only just to like get the people out and doing stuff, but to keep them active and their brains stimulated as much as they can given the circumstances. So, I think that is about it. I hope this wasn't terribly awful. I tried my best. So I hope you guys enjoyed it and learned a little something. And I hope that you guys have a great rest of your day whenever you're watching this, or night or morning or whatever. So thank you. Okay, wait, big psych. I said goodbye, but I didn't mean it. Real quick, very brief, the activity. So almost forgot the most important part of this whole thing, why you guys put an object somewhere that you don't normally put it. I wanted you guys to go and find it. So if you haven't found it yet, pause the video, go find the object, come back. Okay, you're back. So the whole point of that was to kind of simulate how people feel when they have these memory loss problems. I mean, obviously, it's not the same thing, but it's that frustration of not knowing where something is, and that is a big deal for these people. So as Alzheimer's progresses, you see people with more aggression, you know, because they are frustrated that they can't communicate their needs, they can't do the things that they used to be able to do. So I kind of tried to simulate that as best as I could. And then the other thing is the memory games. Research shows that it is very good to keep up with your memory, to kind of work out your brain, if you will. So that's why I'm going to be posting those for you guys. So this is actually goodbye now. Thank you again. And I will talk to you guys later. Again, goodbye.